Rebonjour à tous. Est-ce que je suis bien en train d'enregistrer? Je crois que oui. So I wanted to record for you the last part of this presentation. Excuse me. And so part of it is about the high frequency growth strata and growth structure kinematics. So we've seen in the previous session how sediments and strata, especially the difference in strata between syncline and anticline, how they could be used to reconstruct the kinematics of growth structures with time. We've also seen at the beginning of the lesson how the growth of a structure could modify the stratigraphic record. Now, the idea is to go down a little bit in resolution. And so here what I'm showing is a small sequence of sediments. So you see the strata, they dip toward the left of the photo. That's actually west. And you see the scale. So here are kind of, this is all shallow marine delta X, but this is kind of the distal part of the delta front, and this is more the proximal part of the delta front. So there is a shallowing upward cycle here, and then there is on top a sharp flooding surface, and then there is it starts again with kind of sediments very similar to those distal delta, and then it will increase again to a new sequence. And so these kind of patterns repetitively happen, and we can repetitively describe and observe those small scale sequences. Sometimes they are called genetic units because they are really the building blocks. They are kind of the smallest cycles of advance and retreat of the sedimentary landscape. At a higher resolution, at a smaller temporal scale, what you observe are beds, okay? So no cycles, but really individual beds. So we have the pro-delta, the delta front, and mouth bars here at the top. And carbonate on top, actually. If we look on top in detail, here it's very carbonated. How are these cycles? How to address the influence of tectonics on such cycles of local tectonics. The idea is to look at them, follow them physically, and look at their expression on the hinge of the anticline, on top of the anticline, and in the syncline. And so if we do that, we observe that the following. Here is one of those idealized little sequence with pro-delta marls, delta front here, sandstones, and mouth bars, and then carbonate right on top, and we see them here. So here, this is in the syncline or on the flank of the anticline, at least where there is a bit more space available for sedimentation. And here, this is on top of the anticline. Okay, on top of the anticline, what you have is reduced space because you are on top of the structure. Now, a simple way, or the way some people have interpreted this, is that they have remarked that you have a maximum flooding surface here that you correlate to this one, and you have a flooding surface here that you correlate here, and then the carbonate and the carbonate are also correlated. So here we have quite a difference in thickness. Therefore, there must be fold growth and fold activity. Whereas here, the thickness of those strata are very similar. And so this could be interpreted as quiescence, so no tectonic activity. So if you go this way, it looks like you have a record here of punctuated, pulsated tectonic activity, fold growth, quiescence, fold growth, quiescence, because those cycles repeat themselves with time. And this is what some people have done. Joe Cartwright and colleagues, for instance, that's on a seismic section in the Gulf of Mexico. And you see
you can follow some intervals, and you can probably see that there are cycles. So you always go from a certain seismic facies to a very prominent seismic facies, and then again, and again, and again. So there are cycles here, and there are also faults. And so what they have observed is that if you plot the flow of the faults, c'est-à-dire how much difference there is from the hanging wall and the foot wall for different intervals, you obtain a very staircase-like geometry, where you have periods of thickening in the hanging wall and periods where there is equal thickness in the hanging wall and on the foot wall. And so so this gives this growth and quiescence, and then growth and quiescence, growth and quiescence. And so this gives this really this impression of pulsated tectonic activity, or maybe it's real. What we think and what we've proposed here is that in fact, this observation can also be explained with continuous tectonics, with not stop and go, with not stop and go tectonics, by the fact that these cycles can actually be seen at a much larger scale than the system. They can actually be correlated sometimes to the other side of the basin, and their origin is climatic. It can be sea level, it can be sediment supply, it can be hydrology in the source area, but their origin is at a bigger scale than the local structure. And so what happens here is that if you can actually think about it in terms of superimposing a climatic signal on top of a continuous tectonic signal. And what we realize is that the thickening happens really during the progradation, and the retrogradation part of the sequence has a very similar thickness everywhere. In fact, what probably happens is the following. You have some sort of distortion of your genetic units by tectonics. When sea level is high and the growth, the fault is growing, you are in a situation where you have actually more bathymetry here than here. But all these facies are distal. And so you actually preserve more here than here, but the difference in thickness is not massive. However, when sea level goes down, if tectonics continues and your sea level is lower, you may reach conditions here where it's impossible to preserve sediment, while here in the syncline, you have enough space to accumulate sediment. So you have an erosion on an erosive surface here, and you have deposition here, which counts for no sediment there and a lot of sediment here in the syncline. When sea level rises again, sea level or relative sea level, then you start accumulating again here and on the anticline with differences in facies. And when sea level is at rising fast, then that's where you are going to trap sediment upstream of the system and preserve here carbonates that are going to drape the structure with equal thicknesses or similar thicknesses. So you kind of condense sedimentation, and that's what gives you this kind of equal thickness interval on top of the sequence. So that leads us, in fact, I need to go back. This interpretation here, activity quiescence, is an interpretation that you would do if maybe not consciously, you assume that you always fill your topography to the top. It's called the fill to the top model. It means that you always, every hole you create in the syncline compared to relative to the anticline, the local, this local difference in height is filled to the top, flat. Okay. If you always fill topography to the top, then it's true that when there is an interval with equal thickness in the syncline and in the anticline, on top of the anticline, it means there is no difference in topography. It means there is no tectonic activity. But we can see that this facies is deeper than this one. So there is actually topography. And so this leads us to what we called, it's not a great name, but it's called variable displacement topography model. And so in this case, there is here more dynamic sedimentation. You bring clastic in the system with flows, with currents. And so you tend to fill in the holes. You actually tend to do some kind of fill to the top. And therefore, the difference in thickness reflects at least partly the topographic difference due to tectonics. And here you're in a more non-dynamic environment because sea level is high, clastics are trapped upstream. Here you get only fine grain clastics and carbonates. And so you tend to, your sedimentation tend to drape your topography with equal thickness, whether you're in a low or on a high. Hiscott in 2001 found a very nice, I could find a very nice example of this in a different environment, in a extensional environment, where he showed in northwestern Borneo those sequences where it's clear that, for instance, the high stand system tract is preserved with a much thicker succession here in the syncline of the fault than on the footwall. The low stand is actually mostly bypassed or slumped and deposited only here where you have still a little bit of space. And the transgressive system tract is actually deposited everywhere. So if you look at this, you think, oh, I have an equal thickness here. The fault was not active. And I have a lot of activity here. So the fault was very active. There is perhaps some truth in this, but it also could be that the fault was active all the time. And the difference in thickness you see on both sides of the fault or the non-difference is due to the change of sedimentary processes with time as your sea level is changing and as climate is imposing a sort of cyclicity onto your system. Steph Pocha, my friend Stefan Pocha, developed this a lot during his thesis. In order to measure throw thicknesses in different faults, for instance, in the Niger Delta. And so the theory here is that we have quiescence, growth, inversion, growth, or in a more dynamic model, we can actually, these periods correspond to shale, non-dynamic sedimentation. These periods will correspond to sand. This corresponds to erosion, and this is sand. Therefore, if you assume continuous sedimentation, continuous tectonics, and you look at the pattern of thickening and thinning across a normal fault, you may actually be in a position to predict where are the shale and where are the sands. And so this is what we have done. Applied to the Gulf of Mexico system, this would what Cartwright and others have said is that they could see a polycyclic activity of the faults, yeah, on a time scale of 40,000-50,000 years. Actually, the cyclicity of the parasequences that they could identify on seismic, which I think is a climatic signal, and it corresponds well with the 40 and 50 kilo year cyclic activity. And so our alternative proposition that will need to be tested in the Gulf of Mexico is that, in fact, what we see is a succession of shale and sand that are due, the presence of which is due to the continuous cyclic climatic signal. So we here have potentially a method for the fast track prediction of lithologies from seismic profiles. And so we did it, we tested it in the Niger Delta across one of those faults, and we had test bore holes on both sides of the wall. And we could show that actually in a vast majority of cases, the method actually allows us to predict those periods of slope on the flow versus depth plot, they do correspond with sands, and those periods more flat, they do correspond to shale. In a majority of cases, not in all cases. Other authors, for instance, in Aachen, have also tested the method with some success, for instance, back at the colleagues in 2006. And it's in use at Shell International Exploration and Production. So sometimes starting from a fully, let's say, blue sky idea, such as how does tectonics affect the sequence stratigraphic architecture of my parasequences, can actually lead to surprising and interestingly applicable findings for the society. And so, conclusions here, always have in mind that sedimentation, the sedimentary processes, they change depending on the stratigraphic state of in which you are. So on a succession, there is often an alternation, there is often changes of sedimentation. That's why we identify sequences and cycles, progradation, retrogradation. And since those sedimentary processes evolve with time, they are not going to record deformation in similar ways, even if tectonic was continuous, because you apply on it a filter by the sedimentary processes. We are not always in a position to have a simple reading of deformation. So the difference in thickness between a hanging wall and a foot wall, whether it's a fold or a fault, does not depend only on tectonics. You're not always filling to the top your basin. So reading the simple geometric patterns of sedimentation over growth structures can actually allow prediction of sedimentary processes if one makes the assumption of continuous tectonics. There is argument to say that deformation is continuous at some time scales, actually, when you think about an environment where you are on a delta that is in a state of gravitational collapse, for instance, onto weak layers of salt or shale, maybe you do not expect stop and go tectonics. However, if you're in an area which has large scale lithospheric strike slip faulting, for instance, you may perhaps expect earthquake clustering at certain timescales and some sort of stop and go tectonics that could explain some of those cyclic patterns in sedimentation. In summary, and I can finish here this presentation, we went through how understanding the stratigraphic record requires understanding eustasy, sediment input, but the focus of this presentation also local tectonics, local deformation in a basin. We look at the example of the growth of the Pico del Aguila anticline with a mixed silicic clastic carbonate sedimentation, although I didn't speak much about this, but we've shown that the growth of this anticline is very slow. At the beginning, it's faster, and it can affect the timing of key stratigraphic surfaces. Of course, it affects thicknesses. And finally, at higher frequency, at kind of multimillennial scale climatic sequences, 20, 40, 100,000 kilo years, we've seen that local tectonics can actually distort the stratigraphic record. And this has led us to actually propose a method for the fast track determination or prediction of subsurface lithology. And I leave you there with this very short, I hope not too fast, presentation that terminates our session on your module on called Basin Research, and that very little session on growth strata and the interactions between tectonics and sedimentation. Thanks a lot for your attention, and I will stop the recording. Bye.